Would you kill a koala to save the Great Barrier Reef? Stupid question. Nobody could kill a furry friend with those big brown eyes. And they're not eating the Great Barrier Reef. But this critter is, and it's effectively the same as a koala. No, it's not. I hear you think it's nowhere near as cute. So that makes it okay to kill it, does it? That's a crown of thorns starfish, and they've been accused of eating the Great Barrier Reef. They eat roughly 1 million tons of coral every year, within an order of magnitude. But just as koalas are a native true blue Aussie creature and eat large amounts of Australian gum trees, the starfish is also a completely native Aussie who lives on the Great Barrier Reef. He's not an introduced pest, like cats or pigs or cane toads, for which there is rarely a good reason not to kill them. Would we kill kangaroos if they were eating too much grass? There are often plagues of kangaroos and emus in Australia. Well, actually, graziers sometimes do, but it usually causes an outcry. And it is done for commercial reasons on cattle properties, not as part of a national park like the Great Barrier Reef. And koalas are sometimes get out of control in small areas such as Cape Otway. Do we send in shooters to bag a few thousand drop bears? Can you imagine the outrage? Now, animals occasionally getting into plague numbers has been a story as old as life itself. Plagues of locusts and frogs were documented in biblical times. Nature is not always in that nice, even balance. Sometimes it swings widely as one organism explodes in its numbers and then it dies off. But that it can still be totally natural. But the Australian government is spending tens of millions of dollars each year killing the starfish because it eats corals, and sometimes they denude a few reefs of their branching and staghorn coral. This graph, which is part of some brilliant science, where the Australian Institute of Marine Science has been carefully monitoring huge tracts of the Great Barrier Reef for decades, shows the amount of coral on the reef called Turner K, with a crashing coral after the starfish plagues. This brilliant science has shown that the starfish plagues, they come and they go. So although when people first started worrying about this in the 1960s, the brilliant science has shown that it seems to be a completely natural phenomenon that comes and goes. Anyway, for Turner K, the reef, the critters ate 3/4 of the coral in 2002 and also in 2019, but it always grows back. So what is the science about animals in plague proportions and how should we react to them? Well, the first question is, are the plagues introduced species? If so, I'm afraid, get out the gun. If koalas get introduced into another country and become a nuisance like Aussie possums are in New Zealand's, sorry, koala. If they are natural, the question is, have their numbers got out of control because of something that we humans have been doing? Now, I know what you're thinking. The only question is, are they cute and furry with big brown eyes? In which case, throw out the science out the window and let your emotions dictate proceedings. Well, for COTS, it's the opposite of furry animal syndrome. They're mean and spiky and they don't have proper eyes and they've got far too many legs. And worst of all, they're eating the equivalent of koala, the coral, which is beautiful and marine biologists go all gooey over it all the time. And actually, with pretty good reason, the coral can be utterly spectacular. So why would we want the starfish to eat that? Well, maybe it's because that's what's always happened. And maybe these reefs need to be reset every few years so that the slow-growing corals like these big fellas have a chance. Those acroporas, the plate and staghorn corals, which tend to be eaten the most by the crown of thorns starfish, they're like weeds and they can take over the place. Now, strangely, these questions are rarely asked when the government hands out vast amounts of cash to kill starfish. And the evidence that starfish numbers occasionally explode due to human influence is very, very weak. Check out this video, which we did a few months ago. The Great Barrier Reef is one of the most pristine areas on Earth, with almost no people pressure at all. And the most persistent starfish plagues are the ones that are furthest from the coast, up to 250 kilometres away, the furthest from people. And we fiddle with nature at our peril, especially if we don't actually understand what's going on. And we don't about crown of thorns starfish. That's broken science. Fiddling with things we don't understand while pretending we do. The good news is that the people trying to control the starfish are so ineffective that they're not making a scrap of difference. Each adult crown of thorns starfish produces millions of larvae, and there's millions of starfish, so there's literally gazillions of larvae floating around. It's broken science to think that we can make any difference at all by skewering a few starfish, and it's broken science that they're doing the culling in the first place. But at least it's just a waste of money. And it must be great swimming around the Great Barrier Reef, skewering a few starfish and getting the feeling that you're doing something useful. So, killing these starfish is at worst a victimless crime? Well, not really, because there are plenty of introduced feral animals and plants in Australia that definitely need controlling and are doing a huge amount of damage. Think of what we could do to control those genuine pests with the $20 million a year spent on crown of thorns starfish control. Genuinely introduced species and diseases that have wiped out about half of the 100 species thought to have become extinct in Australia since the 1960s. So maybe we should stop killing these native Aussie starfish that is just doing its job eating coral. Not because it's cute or because it's ugly, but because there are much better candidates for feral animals to work on with the limited funds that we've got.